but unanimous. They recognized a chance, and without speaking all accepted it. So King conceded terms. Daughter of Delight, he said, if in obedience to us you help find treasure, you shall have your share of it. How much? She demanded. But it is wiser, if you want to shorten argument, to let East's daughters bear the market for themselves. How much do you want? King asked, and she named the highest figure she could think of that conveyed a meaning. Hers look nice on paper but are over ambition's head. Alack, she said, laughing at her own exorbitance. Good, if your help is worth an anna you shall have a lakh of rupees. King answered. She demanded, naturally, 2 lakhs after that, but Ali of Sikandarum declaimed on the subject of unfaithfulness. Alack, she had said, alack she should have, his Khyber knife was there to prove it. He was as vehement as if they had the treasure in the room with no more to do than divide it, and she capitulated, more fearful of Ali's northern knife than of all other possible contingencies. She understood the glint in those eyes that were the color of the breeding weather. Alack, she agreed, and then the horses came, and fiscal whispers had to be exchanged between the owner of the horses and the maid, who indubitably swindled everybody, though she had to part with a reward to Ali's son, that being India, specifically Delhi and the seat of government, where extortion is the one art that survives. The horses were an illustration crow's meat, hungry, made to labor for a last rapacious overcharge. But nothing more was required of the horses than a walking pace. The 2 veiled women rode them in the midst of men who were in no haste, because to seem to hasten is to draw attention. It was better to swagger and invite attention, which has a way of producing the opposite effect. They headed as straight as winding ways permitted toward the northern outer fringe of Delhi, where the ruins of the ancient city lie buried amid centuries' growth of jungle. Not a tiger has been seen in that jungle for more than 30 years, but few care to wander at night there, for everything else that is dangerous abides in that impenetrable maze, including fever and fugitives from justice. As they left the last of the modern streets, the moon rose and they followed a track that wound like the course of a hunted jackal between ancient trees whose roots were in much more ancient masonry. The servant of Delight, as she preferred to call herself since her mistress was what she was, held with King's hand on her bridle rein, recognizing the route by things she was afraid of ruins shaped like a human skull that drew a scream from her roots like pythons sprawling in the way a hole in a broken wall that might be a robber's entrance terrified, and yet employing terror consciously enjoying it, as some folk like to sit in a rocking boat and scream. Life to amuse her had to raise the goose flesh and offend the law, both of which are accomplishments of night in northern Delhi, so her faculties were working where others would have turned numb. They came at last to the world's end, where a shadow blacker than a coal mine's throat declared that life left off, and might have been believed except for moonlight that glistened beyond it along the ragged outline of a broken wall. There, under the bough of an enormous tree, whose tendrils looked like hanged men swinging in the wind, they turned into a space once paved so heavily that no trees grew and only bushes strangled themselves, stunted, between masonry. On the far side was a building, still a building, though the upper part had fallen and the front looked like the broken face of a pyramid. Once it had been magnificent. The outside and the upper portions had collapsed from earthquake probably, in such way as to preserve the middle part like the heart of an ant heap. Partly concealed by bushes was an opening indubitably dug by men through the debris. That they entered, into a tunnel that was once a corridor open on one side to the air. And at the end of 50 dark yards, guided by matches struck 2 at a time, they turned to the left into a hall, whose marble sides had been quarried off long ago, but whose columns were still standing like rows of twisted titans holding up the world's foundation. There was a platform at one end, on which had stood a throne. But on it now were a canvas camp bed, an old black handbag with a dirty shirt in it, a couple of pairs of filthy blankets, and a lantern. Someone lighted the lantern, and about 1,000,000 bats took wing, the air was alive with them, and the women hugged their heads, screaming. A few open tin cans tossed into a corner showed how someone had contrived his meals, and one meal at any rate was recent, for there was unspoiled soup remaining in a can beside the bed. But no sign of the Portuguese. Not a hint of where he might be. Only the certainty that he had been there that day. There, on the bed, turned inside out and empty, lay the chamois leather bag that Cyprian had given back to him, but there was no more trace of the coins that had been in it than of Dogama. Narayan Singh was the first to speak. Dogama came for money, sahibs. I heard the boast made that the 9 never lie. He seemed afraid his own word might be doubted since they hadn't found Dogama. Nevertheless, the money that we know he had is missing gone where? He picked up the chamois leather bag and shook it. Up somebody's sleeve, chuckled Jeremy. Look for the Don and I'll bet you. He spoke English, and the women's exclamation stopped him. Ramsden went looking, not so talkative but bashfully aware, as big men sometimes are, of strength and an impulse to apply it. It was foolish to go looking in an empty hall, but men who don't pride themselves on intellect occasionally are better served by intuition. He stooped over where a solitary section of a broken marble column lay on top of debris in a corner of the floor, and they heard his joints crack as he shoved the marble off the heap. "Here's your Portuguese," he said quietly. He might have found a golf ball, but he, too, spoke English and the women exclaimed at it. The maid seized hold of Jeremy's hand and began to examine his fingernails, which informed the practiced eye infallibly, but Jeremy snatched his hand away and hurried to hold the lantern and look with the rest at what Ramsden had discovered. The yellow rays shone on the body of the Portuguese laid dead and hardly cold in a shallow trench hoed in the rubble. The marble column had closed it without crushing what was in there, and the corpse was smiling with the funny, human, easy-natured look that the man had worn in life for fragments of a second as he passed from sneer to sneer. He had died in mid-emotion, and the women vowed the gods had done it. They promised the gods largesse to save them from a like fate. There was no other explanation than theirs of how he died, nor of who else than the gods had killed him. They searched the body. There was no wound, bruise, no smell of acid poison, no snake bite, nothing, but a corpse with a scarred chin, smiling. And no hat. Chapter 5. The nine spies are everywhere. For those who sacrifice themselves upon the altar of her needs, whether supposititious needs or otherwise, India holds recompense, as such quarters, for instance, as Father Cyprian's, wedged between two gardens in a sleepy street, with the chimney of a long-disused pottery kiln casting a shadow like that of a temple dome on the sidewalk in the afternoon. From India's viewpoint, Cyprian was all the more entitled to consideration in that he had never openly conducted any siege against her serried gods. He had saved the face of many a pretending pagan, holding in the privacy of his own conscience that the damned were more in need of comfort than an extra curse. So pagan gratitude had comforted his old bones, unpretending pagans not objecting. He was housed ascetically, but there is a deal more repose and contentment to be had in quiet cloisters than in the palaces of viceroys, princes, bishops. Tongue-in-cheek, he had pretended to the arch-pretenders that he thought their magic formulas bewildering, doing it repeatedly for 50 years until it was second nature, and men, whose minds were rummage shops of all the second-hand old wives' tales, not only used their influence to repay flattery but labored, too, to unearth facts for him beyond their understanding. India, surviving Anglo-Saxon worship of the playing fields and all unnecessary sweat, takes her amusement mentally. It was entertainment exquisite to bring to Father Cyprian, the alien albeit courteous priest, new facts and revel in his intellectual amazement. For in 50 years a man learns how to play parts, and, as Jeremy had noticed, Cyprian was, all things, to a host of various men. He could discuss the metaphysical, remote, aloof though omnipresent all of Parabrahman just as easily as listen to the galloping confession of a gones in haste to unburden conscience and, as it were, dump burdens at the Padre's feet. Shapely, dignified old feet, well cased in patent leather slippers, resting on a folded Afghan shutter to keep them off the tiled floor. Fernandez de Mendoza de Souza Dionde Braganza watched them, as he knelt and searched the very lees of his imagination. He was very proud indeed to confess to Father Cyprian, a rare enough privilege, that of itself, if boasted of sufficiently, would raise him 20 notches in the estimation of the envious world he knew. All he could see below the screen were those old aristocratic-looking slippered feet, but they were reassuring, and he longed to touch them. "And so, Father, that Arab, speaking English very excellently, so that in fact I was awfully taken by astonishment and made suspicious, yes indeed recommended me to come to you for confession." "Why did you obey an Arab?" wondered Cyprian. "Oh, I think he was the devil. How else should he speak English and laugh so lightheartedly? I saw his head against the night sky and I think he had horns, oh yes, certainly." Cyprian cautioned him. "If he was not the devil, that one, then the other was the great brute dressed as a jot who seized me as if I were trash to be thrown away and hurled me against my customers. Father, I assure you I was like a cannonball. He hurled me and I upset many men, oh yes, decidedly. And though the whole hotel was subsequently burned, and from below I saw those very selfsame individuals burning in the flames, I have seen them since. If they are not the devil, they are salamanders. It is not for you to say who the devil is," warned Cyprian, aware of how the gone's mind leaps from one conclusion to another. "How is it you escaped?" "Oh, very simply. I have been most faithful in the matter of the candles for the altar of Our Lady of Goa, so when that I am sure he was the devil hurled me into the ranks of my customers, I was assured in my conscience that that is enough, and I fled first, before there was a stampede, which I foresaw infallibly. So when the stampede began, I was on the stairs, and there I smelt the smoke and went to see as Moses went to see the burning bush, and seeing flame I ran to the street and was saved. But my whole hotel and my fortune are up in flame, oh pity me. So Father Cyprian pitied him with due restraint and dismissed him after a priceless homily in which he pointed out how profitably Dioms might have given all that property to the church instead of keeping it for the devil to make a bonfire of. Hereafter he told his servant to open the slats of the jalousies and admit sufficient of the morning sun to make the place look cheerful. And a plain, cool, white, stone room with an ancient tiled floor and vaulted ceiling is a great deal easier to make cheerful than any sumptuously furnished boudoir in the world. The delights of mild asceticism are immensely keener than the pleasures of the epicure. The sun came in, obedient, and the light and shadow alternated in long triangles on floor and wall, leaving the rear of the room in shadowed mystery. There was no sign of the library, merely a breviary, and one or two books liberally marked with penciled slips on a table against the wall. In addition to the chair that Cyprian used, there were six others, equally simple and equally almost impossibly perfect in design and workmanship, each chair as old as the Taj Mahal and no two chairs alike, yet all one unity because of excellence. A man may be ascetic without craving ugliness and anchorite, in moderation, without shutting out his friends. A bronze bell from a vanished Buddhist temple announced visitors. The servant Manuel, another gone soft-footed as a cat and armed with pots of fuchsias, came in to announce what he regarded as too many visitors at that hour of the morning. They are not elegant, not in the least, oh, no. Their names? Asked Cyprian. Manuel mispronounced them, was reproved, set the pots down, and departed to admit the visitors, changing his mood like a chameleon, only much more swiftly and with rather less success. For instance, it did not convince Calendar Goes, who entered first, as impresario. Hitherto not having poisoned Padre Sahib, said sacred person being vigilant, you therefore impel malevolent influence of evil eye on these unholy Sahibs who are honoring this Babu with employment. Stand back, son of miscegenation. Cease from smiling. Who would smile if addressed in those terms by an arrogantly fat Babu? Not a bishop's butler. Still less Manuel. He scowled, and so tradition says a man must smile before he can blast with that dreadful bane called evil eye in which the whole of the Orient and most of the newer world believes implicitly. Under the protecting scowl, Chulander Goes, with his back to Manuel for extra safety's sake, marshaled the party in Grimm, Jeremy, King, Ramsden, Ali of Sikandarum, Narayan Singh, and one of Ali's sons who was beckoned in by Chulander Goes for keyhole prophylaxis, as the Babu explained in an aside. The other sons remained squatting in the dust in the patterned shadow of a great tree opposite. Falstaff never had a ragger, less royal following as far as mere appearance went inside or outside the priest's house. They all looked like men who trod the long leagues rather than the pavement. For though in the new, raw world, where 20 centuries have not sufficed to give the sons of men a true sense of proportion, he who would be listened to must masquerade and mountebank in new clothes of the newest cut, India knows better, looks deeper, and is more wise. So in vain that net is laid in sight of her. Viceroys, kings, and all their pomp are sideshows, and the noise they make is a nuisance to be tolerated only for the sake of more or less peace. They are heard in the land and not listened to, seen, and appraised like shadows on the sands of time. The men who go in rags out influence them all. Manuel the Gones, for instance, with all European error multiplied within him by miscegenation, scorned that ragged bodyguard beneath the tree for servants of men of no intellect or influence, and even so, a passing constable, with native vision warped by too much European drill, but with all his other faculties and fondnesses alert, paused over the way to meditate how innocence might be made to pay tribute to worldly wisdom, paused, scratching his chin with the butt of a turned wooden truncheon and both eyes roving for a safe accomplice. That constable is a Hindu pig with hair on his liver, who designs an inconvenience to us by Allah, said one hill brother to the next. And all six nodded, in a circle, resembling bears because of sheepskin coats hung loosely on their shoulders. So within, the Padre's servant Manuel approached the seventh, who stood guard by the door of Cyprian's sitting room, offering cakes to Cerberus. Taste it, he suggested. Very excellent from oversea, the land of my ancestors, it came in a great flagon. Only very distinguished people have been given any. A hand like a plucked bear's paw closed tight on the long glass, and with both eyes on the gones, the hillman poured a pint of sweet, strong liquid down his throat, not pausing, not even coughing. The glass was back in the hand of the gones before the other had finished his gasp of astonishment. Hee, you like it, eh? Come, then, into the pantry, where is plenty more. You shall have your fill. No, for I don't drink wine, said Rahman, wiping his lips on a sleeve. Such dogs as thou know nothing of the Quran, but to drink wine is forbidden. In vain the Gones brought more, in a glass jug, tempting scent and vision. Vermont stood with his back to the keyhole, just sufficiently inflamed by one pint of Oporto to have split the Gones' stomach open at the first excuse, and not quite sure that he hadn't already excuse enough for it. So Manuel kept his distance, and the conference within proceeded safely. Cyprian began it naturally, beaming on them with his loose, old lips and eyes that never betrayed secrets. "So you failed. I see you failed," he said, glancing from face to face. "He gave you the slip, that Portuguese." "They killed him," Grimm answered simply. "Ah, a longer spoon than ever. Too bad, but his hat, you found his hat, of course." "No, missing," answered Jeremy. "He had a 5-pun, note inside the band, with my signature." Cyprian's lips moved, but he said nothing audible. "Worse than that," King added. In his pocket should have been a paper on which he had jotted down terms he was prepared to make with us. We wouldn't sign it, but the terms were down and an enemy would draw conclusions. "Gone too?" asked Cyprian. "Yes, taken," King answered. "Pocket was inside out. Worse yet, put in Ramsden. All those ancient coins have disappeared. Here's the bag empty. All except this one." Jeremy held up the one he had given pledge for. Cyprian took it, turning it over and over in a hand as soft and smoothly wrinkled as a royal grandmother's. "Coins gone, hat gone, eh?" said Cyprian. That hat he kept his memoranda on a strip of parchment inside the sweatband. "If we had the hat, well, if we had the hat, I might have fitted his key into my lock, as it were. Well, so we are worse off than before." "Much worse," remarked Chulander Goes. "Flesh creeping, holy one. This Baba, consumed by elementary anxiety, calls attention to arresting key of situation, which is enemy lurking in ambush, is now aware of opponent's identity. Opponents being us, alarming very, unseen, and selecting opportunity with exquisite precision, will sneak forth and smite us shrewdly, wasting no time. Verb, sap, your obedient servant, Sahibs." "He knows," said Cyprian nodding. "He knows." Ramsden half unconsciously clenched two enormous fists, and Cyprian laughed. "If we could deal with them in that way, their secret would have been the world's 5,000 years ago, wouldn't it?" He said whimsically, "No, my friends, they may do violence to us, we must admit that possibility. But it behooves us to use other means. We are lost if we try violence, babes in the wood, eh? No, what's safer then than Sennacherib's Assyrians? We might as well walk barefoot into a cabin full of snakes. But the Lord slew the Assyrians. The Lord, too, fought against Sisera. Wisdom. We must be wise, you understand me." He was trying to be all things at the same time to seven men of differing creeds, not one of which was his, and he was much too wise to venture on the freehold of religion, although that, and no other motive, was the impulse that had kept him laboring for 50 years. He knew that Jeremy, for one, would openly revel at the first suggestion of creed or dogma, to say nothing of Narayan Singh and Ali of Sikandaram, who perhaps were not so important, although quite as unwilling to be compromised. "Nobody understands a damn thing," answered Jeremy. "I know what we saw, a dead Don minus hat, and his pockets inside out. We all know what the woman said. I've heard you. It all amounts to nothing, plus one gold coin." "Perhaps I'd better hear about the woman," Cyprian suggested. Jeremy told him, reproducing the whole scene and Gori's conversation, down to the last remark of Gori when she saw Dalgama lying dead. See, they fooled him, and the fool tricked me. I am a greater fool. I tell you, none but a fakir has the better of a fakir. Men say of me, and such as me, that I learn secrets. Fag, go and be fakirs, all of you. That's what Gori thought of it," said Jeremy. "And she was right. She was right," said Cyprian. Whereat Jeremy whistled. He smelt adventure coining downwind unexpected just the way he likes it best. Chulander Goes, who loves to feel his own flesh creep, made a noise like a stifled squeal and shivered. "Padre Sahib, be advised by me," he interrupted. "Being far from a fluent Baba, perspiring much for underdone emolument, I'm nevertheless like package of autolichus containing products of experience. That Mr. Ross can be a fakir, yes. He is so clever, he can even imitate himself, same being most difficult of all cynicisms. But he is Australian. His deity is nth power of irreverence, same if brought in contact with high church parties lacking sense of humor, being much more dangerous than dynamite with fuse and caps. I speak with feeling. Mr. Ross will make conjuring tricks with 7-knotted bamboo rod of holiest Mahatma, and we are all dead men families at mercy of the rising generation, oh, my aunt." Jeremy smiled, pleased, he likes applause. Head suddenly on one side like a terrier's who hears the word cat, he watched Cyprian's face, alert. There is truth in what Chulender Ghost says, truth and exaggeration, Cyprian announced. There is always danger in attacking deviltry, but exaggeration in such cases is, he was going to say a sin, but checked himself, a serious mistake because it terrifies. Every man in the room except Chulender Ghost smiled broadly at that. Cyprian smiled too, and none of them, except perhaps the Babu, realized that he had chosen that means of eliminating any shade of terror from the argument. You, he said suddenly, pointing a finger at Jeremy. You, are you able to govern yourself? Can you understand that if you play this part, one laugh at the wrong minute may mean death? I hope I'll die laughing in my boots, responded Jeremy. Your death and others. Whose, for instance? Jeremy came back at him. I've seen men in India I'd kill for sixpence each. These your friends, said Cyprian. That's different. All right, I don't laugh. I make up as the lousiest looking holy man you ever saw. What after that? Demanded Jeremy. Cyprian looked hard at him. In one soft palm lay the gold coin, and he tapped it with a forefinger. This is our only point of contact, he began. You must take it and do tricks. You must challenge the nine in public. It is dangerous, and others must go with you to prevent abduction. Are you willing? Bet your life, said Jeremy. Who comes? Oh, my God, remarked Chulender Ghost, aware of the wheels of destiny. My young friend Jeremy, do you command sufficient self-control to let yourself be disciplined by our Babu? Asked Cyprian. The Padre's lips moved pursily, as if he were masticating something, and his face was toward Jeremy, who grinned, but his mind was already far away considering something else. Grim noticed it and grew aware that Cyprian had made his mind up without waiting for the answer. Quick work, but Grim is constitutionally cautious. How about the Babu? He objected. Can Chulender goes, Cyprian banished the objection with a gesture. You must be dumb, friend Jeremy dumb. He went on, forcing deep thought to the surface through a sieve that strained out all unnecessary words, particularly all unnecessary argument. Chulender goes must talk. My God, you see me shudder, exclaimed the Babu, not exaggerating. His fat shoulders heaved as if an earthquake underlay them, and a kind of grayness settled on his face. Nevertheless, none doubted his intention. A century or two ago he would have braved the Holy Inquisition out of curiosity. Whatever is said, Chulender goes must say, repeated Cyprian. Hear me say it now, then. Caesar, moratoris te saluto. Speech committing me, silence absolves actual offender. My belly shakes, yet family must eat. Sahibs, increase my microscopical emolument. Never was a man more serious. Chulender goes, all clammy with anxiety, rolled his handkerchief into a ball and caught it with his naked toes repeatedly, but King moved over and sat on a cushion on the floor beside him. You and I have tackled worse than this together, he said. Ah, yes, you and I, but this Australian, he would tie a knot in the tail of Hanuman asterisk himself and trust to irreverence to get him out of it. He will cry, Kue, and pretend to a Brahmin that such is colloquial lingua franca of the gods. Asterisk the monkey god. It is, laughed Jeremy, Australia's god's country. If I can't talk the dialect, who can? Peace, peace, said Cyprian, smiling. Let us joke afterward. Colonel King, may I trust you to instruct friend Jeremy drill him, that is. We cannot afford mistakes. King nodded. In all India there was none else who had traveled, as King had done, from end to end of India in different disguises, penetrating the reputedly impenetrable. If King had but possessed a tithe of Jeremy's gift of doing marvels with his hands, he would have been the man to send. But you don't discover jealousy in men of King's attainments. A trace of that would have made them fail 100 times. Both he and Grimm were safer men than Jeremy, and knew it, but they were also much less brilliant, and knew that too. As far as courage went there was nothing to choose, although they would all have picked on Ramsden if asked who was least amenable to fear, and Ramsden, knowing too well what it cost him to control those thews of his, would have picked Narayan Singh. You know there is a Hindu festival at Benares very soon, said Cyprian. I am old, or I would go with you. I know those ceremonies. I could guard against mistakes. Now, understand, the danger is abduction. There will be 1 million men and women in Benares more. You disguised unknown you could vanish as easily as 7 pebbles from the beach. So you must all go, each to watch the others. Be 2 parties. Jeremy, Chulender goes, Ramsden 1. The other, all the rest of you, pretending to be strangers to the first. But all Hindus, mind able to claim acquaintance if you must. We shall be in next world very presently. Remarked Chulender goes. What is object of this impropriety? Cyprian made a noise with his tongue. He did not like the word impropriety. He answered, looking anywhere but at the Babu. The nine unknown must keep themselves constantly informed. In order to know, they must observe. To observe, they must go, or send their representatives. To be in touch with the mind of the mass, which their purpose must be, certainly they will take care to attend the festivals, in person or by proxy. If one of their number should go to Benares, as is possible, extra precautions will be taken, of course, to preserve incognito. But in any case, there will be at least one of their principal lieutenants there to bring dependable reports. You understand that, now. The old man was warming up. He moved in his chair restlessly and kept wiping his lips on a lawn handkerchief. His gestures, losing the indeterminate, painstakingly tactful quality, were becoming imperative. In cryptographic books in my possession, it is laid down as inviolable rule that one of the nine always visits Benares at this season of the year. They receive money, gold, and silver. That accumulation never ceases. And the East changes slowly, without a doubt. A great deal of the money, even in these days of banks, goes to Benares, hard work, Prayag, and such places by porter at the times of pilgrimage. Someone is there to receive it. You understand? Ramsden opened his mouth at last. Economy, constructive pioneer economy, was his long suit. It would take a freight train to haul the money. The amount that disappears in 1 year could be carried among a million pilgrims without attracting notice, Cyprian retorted. Do you realize your opportunity? Contact is our problem. If by challenging attention, you can once make contact with the nine unknown, you may leave the rest to me. We will presently find the books. Then you may have the money, anyone may have it. The books, those nine books, they are the true goal. If the cash really goes to Benares, it would take a train to haul it out. Ramsden insisted. In that case, we need only watch the railway. Who said the money is hauled out again? Cyprian retorted testily. For all you know, there is a hole under a temple in Benares. He checked himself, aware that for the first time he had awakened incredulity. Even Chulander goes aloud, an expression of mockery to light his face up suddenly. Ali of Sikandarum exploded. Allah, if the Hindus had that much money in a hole beneath a temple, the hills would have smelt it years ago. Moreover, would the English not have learned of it? They smell gold as a thirsty horse smells water in the plains. And if the English were afraid to take it on a pretext, would the hills refrain? Would that bait not have brought the Lashkar's asterisk yelling down the Khyber? And would guns have held them back in smell of all that loot? Allah, show me but one sack of gold, and I will show you how hillmen plunder I and my sons. Asterisk hillmen armies. But Ali of Sikandarum was wax in Cyprian's hands. Swift, subtle flattery turned his indignation into boasting, out of which net there was no retreat. You and your sons invaluable. Splendid. You should have a part, but oh, the pity of it. You are Muslims. Aye, the pity of it, answered Ali. When the Sarkar needed men to go to Lhasa who should not upset the heathen bellies of Thebesians with a true religion, was I chosen with three sons to make that journey because we could not act Hindu? Doubtless. Bring me 1,000 Hindus, and if one of them can pick me out of a crowd as not being a Hindu of the Kshatriya caste, I will go back to my hills and hold my peace. But not in Benares. You would not dare in Benares, suggested Cyprian. By Allah, in Benares they shall think me a double holy Brahmin born in paradise. I will have the sadhus kissing feet within the hour. So, excellent, said Cyprian. That is, if you dare. I would like to see the thing I dare not do, I and my sons, answered Ali. You speak of them as yours. I would rather heat them pledge themselves, said Cyprian. By Allah, they will swear to what I bid them swear to, answered Ali. If I say a hill is flat, they prove it. If I say a Hindu wears his belly inside out, they demonstrate that, too, on the nearest unbeliever. If I bid them be Hindus, they will even shave themselves and look that part. Wait and see, I will bring them in. He strode to the door to tell Rahman, who was standing guard, to go and summon them. Rahman went off to obey and the door was closed again, but opened a minute later by Chulander Ghose, who leaned his whole weight on the knob and used it suddenly. Manuel, the butler, entered on his knees and fell face downward, saying nothing, amid silence. Eavesdropping, exclaimed Cyprian at last. The Ghose did not answer, too afraid, or too wise. He lay with his face between his hands in an attitude of abject supplication. Put him outside for the present, ordered Cyprian, and Ramsden took Manuel by the waistband, tossing him into the pantry as you throw a stick into the fire. I tell you, said Cyprian, we war with